The Senate will come to order. I ask everyone present to please rise and recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. In the absence of clergy, let us bow our heads in a moment of silent reflection or prayer. Reading of the journal.
In Senate, Monday, April 4th, 2022, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Sunday, April 3rd, 2022, was read and approved on motion the Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions. Messages from the Assembly. Messages from the Governor. Reports of standing committees. Reports of select committees. Communications and reports from state offices. Motions and resolutions. Senator Gennaris.
Mr. President, I move to adopt the resolution calendar.
All those in favor of adopting the resolution calendar, please signify by saying aye. Opposed, nay. The resolution calendar is adopted. Harris.
We're going to return to the resolution calendar a little bit later, but for now, let's take up the calendar.
Secretary Reed.
Calendar number 90, Senate Print 1138 by Senator Harkin, an act authorizing the Commission of General Services to convey real property in Westchester County to the County of Westchester.
There is a homeroom message at the desk. Read the last section.
Section 5, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 576, Senate Print 6499 by Senator Horman, an act to amend the Surrogate Courts Procedure Act.
Read the last section.
Section 7, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 576, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Borrello, Griffo, Helming, Oberacker, O'Mara, Serino, and Tedisco. Aye 55, nays 7.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 584, Senate Print 554 by Senator May, an act to amend the elder law and the economic development law.
Read the last section.
Section 3, this act shall take effect on the 90th day and shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Senator May to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to thank the leadership and my colleagues for their support of this bill. Encore entrepreneurship is about helping people in their 50s and older who want to start their own businesses. Often they make this choice after encountering ageism in the workplace. Many have business ideas that address the needs of our growing population of seniors. People in this age group bring a lifetime of experience and a strong work ethic to their entrepreneurial activities, but they may also experience barriers when it comes to entering the competitive world of small business as a senior. Navigating rapid technological change, understanding the ins and outs of marketing in the digital age, or of recruiting and managing staff as hiring practices and work expectations are in such flux. These are all areas where seniors may need additional support to make their business ideas a success. In the spirit of encouraging entrepreneurship, of helping New Yorkers remain productive later in life, of supporting good ideas for small business development, and of combating age discrimination, I proudly vote aye. Thank you.
Senator May to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
Ayes 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 593, Senate Print 5938 by Senator Parker, an act to amend the mental hygiene law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Ort, O'Mara. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 593, those senators voted in the negative are Senators O'Mara and Ort. Ayes 60, nays 2.
The bill's passed.
Calendar number 629, Senate Print 252A by Senator Thomas, an act to amend the Vehicle and Traffic Law and the Public Officers Law.
Read the last section.
Section 5, this act shall take effect on the 30th day after it shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 647, Senate Print 8267 by Senator Gorin, an act in relation to authorizing the assessor of the town of Huntington, County of Suffolk, to accept from the Huntington Public Library an application from exemption from real property taxes.
Read the last section.
Section 2. This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Counter.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 647, voted in the negative, Senator Akshar, I 61, nays 1.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 653, Senate print 2903A by Senator Kavanaugh, enactment of the Criminal Procedure Act.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 90th day, which shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 653, those senators voted in negative are Senators Borrello, Griffo, Helming, Jordan, Lanza, Oberacker, O'Mara, Rath, and Serino. Senator Tedisco. Also, Senator Tedisco and Palumbo. I 51, nays 11.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 713, Senate print 5237B by Senator Gorin, enactment of the public authorities law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect on the 120th day and it shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results.
Ayes 62.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 734, Senate print 6172A by Senator Hoyleman, enactment of the environmental conservation law.
Read the last section.
Section 4, this act shall take effect on the 30th day of the shall become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White. Oberacker.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 734, voted in the negative, Senator Oberacker. Ayes 61, nays 1.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 735, Senate print 6510 by Senator Mannion, an act to amend the environmental conservation law.
Read the last section.
Section 2, this act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Giannaris, Krueger, Ort, Stewart, Cousins, White.
Announce the results. Oh. Senator Mannion to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. Big game hunting is a big part of the heritage of New York State. It's an activity that connects generations of New Yorkers to each other and to the outdoors. This legislation is about promoting economic activity. It's about promoting conservation, and it's about promoting the safe enjoyment of the outdoors with your loved ones during the holiday season. It's also about respecting hunters, proper management of our wildlife resources, and empowering localities to make their own decisions regarding the value and safety of hosting holiday activities, including a holiday hunt, in their communities. The hunting organizations and the local governments are some of the most supportive of this legislation. The New York Bow Hunters Association says, and I quote, "The white-tailed deer population is exhausted by this point in the winter. Continuing hunting pressure would be detrimental to the deer population." And in its support, the New York Farm Bureau notes that New York State currently has one of the longest deer seasons in the country, and that it is important for counties to be able to promote their own winter economic growth. Holiday hunts can force snowmobile trails to close and make hiking trails and the woods more dangerous as more people venture outdoors during this holiday time. New York's natural resources must be protected so they can be enjoyed by the public in perpetuity. This legislation is in that spirit and towards that goal, and for those reasons, I vote in the affirmative. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Mannion to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 735, those senators voted in the negative are Senators Borrello, Gallivan, Griffo, Helming, Lanza, Martucci, Oberacker, O'Mara, Palumbo, Rath, Ritchie, Serino, Steck, and White. Also, Senator Tedisco. Ayes 47, nays 15.
The bill is passed. Senator Janaris, that completes the reading of today's calendar.
Let's go back to resolutions, Mr. President, take up previously adopted resolution 2176 by Senator Ryan, read its title, and recognize Senator Ryan.
Secretary will read.
Senate resolution 2176 by Senator Ryan, memorializing Governor Kathy Hochul to proclaim April 3rd through 9th, 2022 as Library Week in the state of New York.
Senator Ryan on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. You're not going to believe it, but this week is the 64th annual National Library Week. First celebrated in 1958, it's a national observance celebrated by the American Library Association in libraries in every county across the state and across the country in April. It's a great opportunity to highlight the value of our libraries and to celebrate the hard work of the librarians and library staffs who support our libraries across the state and the country. As a longtime supporter of our state libraries, I have seen firsthand how important libraries are to all New Yorkers. They've always been important tools for promoting literacy, and they still perform that function today. But boy, have they taken on many more roles in our community since then. So the theme of this year's National Library Week is connecting with your library, and the operative word is connected. For many years, we thought about being connected with libraries through books, but there's many more connections now we have to our libraries, education programmings, bringing members of the communities in, and of course, in the 21st century, we connect through our libraries with computers, with the internet, technological resources that helps people apply for jobs, learn English language, and so much more. During the pandemic, we discovered how important this work is to New Yorkers. And providing internet access to the library, it really has made libraries a vital resource for many workers working remotely, learning remotely, taking medical appointments remotely. Their ability to bridge the digital divide has been a crucial resource to underserved communities. And as chair of the Libraries Committee, I'm honored to introduce this resolution recognizing April 3rd to April 9th as the 64th annual Library Week in New York State. And I look forward to commemorating this week by recognizing the outstanding librarians throughout the state. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Ryan. Senator Harkin on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to thank my colleague, Senator Ryan, for bringing this resolution. And I, too, would like to take a moment to thank our librarians and all those who work and volunteer in libraries for all they do. As Senator Ryan so aptly mentioned, for so many years, libraries were centers of literacy and to promote art and culture and reading. And today, they are so much more. In my district, they are places for after-school tutoring. They are places for people who do not have access to computers, to learn computer skills, to be more employable, to access job boards that may not have computers at home, and of course for the broadband deserts that we talk about and we work so hard in this chamber. I have both urban broadband deserts and I have rural broadband deserts in my district, and it's a great place for students and others to come in order to get their work done. You know, we have had during power outages, our parking lots of our libraries are filled with folks trying to get broadband. After hours, students are in the parking lots trying to get broadband. Some of our libraries have extended hours, so students who don't have broadband at home can get broadband access. So libraries have become much more important to the fabric, not just of our communities, where they will always be, but to the fabric of our economy and our education system. So I want to thank Senator Ryan for bringing this resolution. I thank our librarians, and I vote aye.
Thank you, Senator Harkin. Senator Jackson on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise this afternoon in order to support the resolution, but I thank my colleague, Senator Ryan, for the resolution to proclaim April 3rd to April 9th as National Library Week in our state. National Library Week is a time to celebrate our nation's libraries and library workers' contributions and promote library use and support across the country and our state. After all we have to dash to the library to borrow our favorite books. We all have to visit a library to study. And we've spent endless hours revising or reviewing for exams, borrowing textbooks, and reading free journals in a library. You remember all of that? Well, do you remember that feeling of getting a brand new library card? I do. Of course, that was many decades ago. But libraries have such a special place in our heart of all New Yorkers. Libraries are a place where communities connect to books, to classes, things like broadband, computers, programs, movies, video games, and a safe haven for many of the children after school, when we know that. But the most important, libraries connect us to one another. A great example of this happened in Northern Manhattan, part of my district, Inwood, that I represent before I was elected in office, when I joined a class grassroots movement to save the Inwood Library in 2017. That library united folks from different backgrounds with the sole purpose of protecting our library, a powerful experience indeed. Today, U.S. libraries face many, many challenges besides funding, and yet they continue finding innovative ways to meet the needs of our communities. Yet library staff in every state face an unprecedented number of attempts to ban books. The American Library Association's Office of Intellectual Freedom tracked 729 challenges to libraries, school, and university materials and services in 2021, resulting in 1,597 individual book challenges or removed. Most targeted books were about Black or LGBTQIA plus persons. And because of this, we must support our libraries today more than ever, allowing all of us to read and understand each other better. To read to be able to embrace and celebrate diversity. To read and explore the possibility of a better world, one of inclusion. Let's not forget that the first National Library Week was observed, as my colleague said, in 1958. Because many were concerned that Americans were reading less. The theme was, wake up and read! A message I believe we all greatly appreciate today. Lastly, to all the librarians who continue to help our children, young adults, and seniors on their behalf, I thank you for everything that you do. And I am proud to stand here today to support this resolution to proclaim National Library Week in New York State. And I vote aye, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Jackson. Senator Jordan on the resolution.
Mr. President and my colleagues, I'm proud to speak on the resolution before us, brought by my colleague and chair of our Senate Libraries Committee, Senator Ryan. As the ranking member of our Senate Libraries Committee, as one of the founders of our fantastic Clifton Park Half Moon Public Library, and as a director of the Clifton Park Half Moon Library Foundation, and as a lifelong advocate of libraries, literacy, and learning, I'm happy to strongly support this resolution memorializing the governor to proclaim April 3rd through the 9th as Library Week here in New York State in conjunction with the observance of National Library Week. This week in particular marks a terrific time to reflect on the vital role that our excellent public libraries play, along with our fantastic, dedicated librarians and library workers. This year marks the 64th anniversary of National Library Week, a celebration and recognition sponsored by the American Library Association and libraries nationwide. Libraries give us so much more and contribute to our special quality of life and about so much more than just books. They're beloved centers of creativity, places that inspire, lighting a spark of imagination and fanning the flame of curiosity, adventure, understanding, and sense of wonder for exploring our larger world and beyond. As the times have changed, so too have our tremendous public libraries, as they now do more than ever before. Our public libraries help connect communities with technology and continue assisting countless families, students, and individuals in closing the digital divide. Libraries also sponsor classes, workshops, resumes, resume assistance, help job seekers, hold creativity classes, provide family-friendly entertainment and resources for small businesses, and are the world-class centers for true, credible research, and so much more. Most of all, our public libraries are welcoming, essential community resources that help support and strengthen all New Yorkers. I'll close with a quote about libraries by Sidney Sheldon that says it all. Libraries store the energy that fuels the imagination. They open up windows to the world and inspire us to explore and achieve and contribute to improving our quality of life. Many thanks to all of our excellent public libraries and to our skilled, dedicated librarians. Thank you for all you do. I'm proud to support this resolution. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Jordan. Senator Borrello on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to also support Library Week. I'd like to thank Senator Ryan for his sponsorship of this bill. I think despite all that we've said and how wonderful our libraries are, we still have a challenge out there. The challenge is often people think of libraries as just the place where books are. But they are so much more. And as everyone has so eloquently spoken about that, I want to focus on the fact that during the pandemic, we really did realize how vital our libraries were. We realized how essential our librarians were. They were too essential workers. During the pandemic, when people couldn't get access to things like the internet, the libraries were there for them. When they had trouble navigating things like how to fill out an unemployment insurance form or fill out the endless paperwork to get some pandemic relief money for their business, our libraries were there to help them. This is an essential service that is often overlooked because many times, as a veteran of local government, library funding is one of the first things on the chopping block when things get tough. And we need to make sure that that never happens, because they are essential. In rural communities like mine, they are critically important. They are true community centers where important things happen and people who are often very desperate for help get the help and guidance that they need. So, Mr. President, I proudly support this and vote aye. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Borrello. Senator Hinchey on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President, and I want to thank the sponsor, Senator Ryan, for bringing this resolution forward. Equal access to information is one of the great things that sets our country apart from so many others across the world, and that is exactly what our public libraries and our libraries provide. And yet they often do not get the due or the attention or the recognition that they're owed and that we should. Especially in upstate and rural communities like the ones that I represent, representing five counties, we have a lot of incredible libraries that are quite literally the lifeline for so many people in our communities. Of course, they provide literacy options and books and incredible escapisms to places that some people may never be able to travel themselves. But they also, as has been said today eloquently by my colleague, Senator Harkin, they became such a lifeline for broadband during this pandemic. In our rural areas where we have some deep, deep broadband deserts, people had to decide if they could go to work or go to school. People had to sit outside these libraries and be able to actually do their work or learn, continue their education, be able to look for that next job when they may have gotten laid off over the pandemic. These are services that are offered almost nowhere else except for the parking lots of our libraries. For instance, the library in Caro, a very rural town in Greene County, that library has become a community hub. They do food drives, they do book drives. They actually offer community college courses at the library because the community college is over the river. They've become a real epicenter of community work. And those in Tannersville, those the library in Gilderland, which just went through an incredible renovation, has made it a point to make sure that they're welcoming new Americans and immigrants and anyone moving into the community that's new to be a welcoming space for people and providing them access to things that they may not have had in the place where they came from. Our libraries are so profoundly important, and again, they do not get the recognition that they are often owed. And so having this week is an incredibly special and important week to make sure that we are paying our respects to the volunteers and the library workers who do this really important work in communities across our state. So thank you, Senator Ryan, for bringing this resolution forward, and I proudly vote aye.
Thank you, Senator Hinchy. Senator May on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. I am very glad to speak about our great libraries in the state and to thank Senator Ryan for bringing this resolution forward. Free public libraries were invented in America about 200 years ago. Over the last few decades, we have seen in this country a massive effort to privatize everything from schools to parks to water systems. Libraries face pressure too. I, for one, will continue to fight against predatory library pricing for e-books from major corporate publishers. But in general, libraries have bucked the privatization trend and continue to serve every community in the most egalitarian way possible. Local libraries and countywide library systems aren't just resources for books and digital items, as we've heard. They are gathering places for community groups. They provide access to lawyers and tax professionals. They host maker spaces, knitting groups, and children's story times. Rural families, struggling to manage remote schooling over the last 2 years have depended on libraries for internet connection. For people struggling with homelessness, libraries provide a place to use a bathroom or to sit in a comfortable chair for a few hours. I'm proud that my library system just decided to abolish late fees. They're forgoing $280,000 in fines to eliminate what is a real barrier to many children and people of very limited means, and to assure access to all members of the community. This is the library ideal, serving the principles that democracy depends on an educated populace and that books and information should be available to all. I vote aye.
Thank you, Senator May. Senator Brooks on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Senator Ryan, for introducing this resolution. For me, libraries go way back, back not quite to the 1800s, and we didn't bring our horse to the library. But we date back to a time when going to school, most of us didn't have an encyclopedia at home. And after school, everybody ended up at the library pulling all the encyclopedias, doing the research that they had to do. And you saw the library back then as a source to help you educate yourself. The role in the library has changed so much in the last few years. In dealing with the various library directors, and I meet with them every couple of months, and they're really enthusiastic about what they do, but they also talk about the concerns they have. How many people walk in with various problems because they don't trust any other level of government to get the right information? And on a cold day, people who don't have any shelter show up at the library, or a rainy day, they show up at the library. One of the things we did with the county at one time and made arrangements for some of the social workers from the county to come to the libraries on certain days to help people because they saw the library as a center to get help. You look at the library, I get a kick out of my library. I know the local library director, I generally give him a hard time, but my granddaughter started going to the library for a book reading program, and they didn't know who she was. And the coloring books that we have, there were some of those at the library. So she flips the page out, they were giving them out to the kids. She looks down and goes, "Grandpa!" The picture, and they all look. But she built such a love for reading in the library. And she got to the point that she was taking 5 and 6 books out and finishing them in a week's time because of what was instilled there. So the libraries, for so many of us, were that cornerstone, our thirst for learning that carried through. As has been mentioned here, the libraries have changed their role. In many of the communities that I represent, computers at home are something they don't have. They go to the library to use that after school. In some communities, they go to the library after school because that's a safe place. The folks that operate the libraries are very dedicated people who understand their expanding role, serving our seniors, serving the children, serving people with disabilities, serving people that don't have. They do a great job. I think something that was mentioned here, the electronic books, we've really got to monitor what's happening with those in terms of expense. That's one of their number one concerns. And I think all of us hear from our local libraries that they need money to do work on their buildings. They've gone a long, long time. So we've got to dedicate that. But at the end of the day, I think the library is one of the best assets we have in our communities. The folks that work in those libraries are dedicated and concerned about the community, and we bring so many programs through the library to people in the community that otherwise wouldn't have anything. So I thank Senator Ryan for bringing this resolution, and I thank everybody in this state associated with libraries for what they do for their communities. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Brooks. Senator Boyle on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. On the resolution, I'd like to thank sponsor Senator Ryan, our ranker, Senator Jordan, for this resolution. With the advent of the digital age, I was a little concerned about what was going to happen to our libraries, and can gladly report that they are stronger and more vibrant than ever. True, as was said, community centers, activity centers. I spend a lot of time in libraries. My office, we do about 55 programs a year, and the vast majority of them are held in our libraries. Blood drives, coat drives, you name it, we do it. They're always there. And I'm amazed when I go to these libraries in the 4th Senate District about something new that's always happening. Walking by a room, what's going on there? That's virtual reality. What's going on there? A karaoke. Soundproof room, but the karaoke is going on in our libraries. It's not just books, it's so many more active and community-based, family-based activities. We have a brand new library in the 4th Senate District, Bayport Blue Point. Two community leaders, Ronnie Devine and Councilman Neil Foley, were active in creating this beautiful new library, so the future is wide open. Cannot thank them enough. And just politically speaking, to my colleagues, when the Republicans were in the majority, we put a lot of money in libraries. We were champions for libraries. And to tell the new majority, put your money in libraries. Because you know when you get a member item and you give it to a school district, they're going to say, is that all? Libraries, thank you for $5,000, $10,000. Like, it's manna from heaven. They need it, they use it, and it's great for our communities. I vote in favor.
Thank you, Senator Boyle. Senator Cooney on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. You and I are about the same age, so it's a little strange to be able to say this, but about 30 years ago, I started my first job, and I walked into the then Highland Branch Library, now Frederick Douglass Library, as part of the Rochester Public Library System. I served as a page, where I actually used to take books around on a cart, put them back on the shelf, and shelve them again. Libraries have come a long way, and many of the senators here today have talked about that, and so I'm so grateful to Senator Ryan for his leadership on the Libraries Committee, and thank you, Senator Ryan, for also coming to Rochester and seeing some of our libraries during the off session. Libraries have changed, and so Senator Jordan said they've become career centers. Today's libraries are about resume writing and helping people access employment opportunities. As my friend and colleague Senator Hinchey talked about, it's an opportunity for the new American community to access some of the services that we have in this great country and to prepare for their own citizenship test. And for me, libraries are a gateway to where we want to go as in our economic future for New York State. So we talk a lot about what are those new emerging industries in New York that we can help prepare young people for the next generation of jobs. Digital gaming, video production, not something that you normally think about in terms of libraries, but you do in the Monroe Public Library System. You do in your library systems across New York State. And so I'm grateful for our librarians who came from Monroe County and Greater Rochester, from the Greece Library System, from the Strong Museum, to be with us here today. And I want to thank all of our librarians and my former bosses who allowed me to have a career in public service. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Cooney. Senator Serino on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. You know, Senator Brooks, you said it so well, you know, when you talk about our stories from when we were a kid and remembering our libraries. And I have to tell you, our libraries are so integral to our communities. And I think about being a single mom when I didn't have a lot of money, and it was great to be able to go to the library. And looking at our what's going on now in our world today too, people that don't, they're struggling, they go to the libraries, they use their broadband, the seniors that need to want to have some communication and socialization, whether they're knitting or playing games, but our libraries have so much to offer. So Senator Ryan, thank you for moving this bill forward, and also a huge thank you to all of our librarians and libraries. They have been such an integral part, especially through COVID. It's been wonderful, so thank you.
Thank you, Senator Serino. The resolution was previously adopted on March 29th. Senator Gennaris.
Thank you, Mr. President. I feel compelled to state for the record that you are, in fact, younger than Senator Cooney.
The record shall reflect, Senator Gennaris. So
any,
ordered.
Is there any further business at the desk?
There is no further business at the desk.
Move to adjourn until tomorrow, Wednesday, April 6th at 11 a.m.
On motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Wednesday, April 6th at 11 a.m.